Good afternoon, friends. So today topic is assessment. What exactly we mean by assessment and how the assessment need to be validated in the case of outcome based education. So as you all aware, is it I am audible, Basim?
Yes sir. I'll make you a host, sir, now.
I started lecturing. Kalipan sir, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, professor.
So you're all working from home or you went to the office, started?
We are in home only, professor. Home only.
So luckily now, yesterday the sanitary inspectors, they all visited our institute because we conducted CAA exam and now IIT current.
No, sir, voice is not audible actually.
It's audible, sir.
Yeah.
Good afternoon. It's my pleasure to join in the team. And today the topic is assessment. Assessment is very easy to do because we always do assessment. We always do evaluation with purpose, without purpose, with right, without right. We always have assessment. Even if you watch any movie, we do assess. Oh, this is a, we evaluate. This movie is this quality, this movie is this quality. And it varies also. It depends because the results are not one and the same. If I do assessment, if others do assessment, the results always differ. Why the results? There is a difference in the results. That is a qualitative and quantitative, sir. We have to remember there are two terminology, quantitative assessment, qualitative assessment. And sometimes we call it as a norm reference test and criterion reference test. We fix some norms. Among the students, we get some norms. We fix some criteria, we evaluate. So these are some fundamentals of assessment which we need to take into consideration. And I know it is after lunch. The session is really going to be a challenge, not only to you, to me also, because after every lunch, we have to deliver lecture. After every lunch, you have to listen to the lecture. Listening is difficult, but for us, delivering is a little bit easy. But assessment plays an important role in redefining our learning process, So let me start the session as usual with the mentee poll. I just want to start with mentee poll. I request, my dear friends, around 41 participants are there. I don't know how many of them will participate, but it will be good if you can participate. And you can contribute to the mentee quiz. So I am sharing the mentee quiz with the participants. Okay, once again, I go to share button. I copy the link. I put it in the chat. Yes, chat. I am giving the chat in chat. You can click and you can participate in the quiz. Else, you can also go to menti.com. One more option is go to menti.com. Menti.com and you can type the code. Whichever option is available. Suppose if you are having the mobile phone Menti app, if you're having, you can type the code. 1632 1632397. That is there. Either you can copy the link and you can participate or you can do it. Is it clear, my dear friends? So just we will start the mentee quiz. The first question is, what concerns do instructors have in assessment? As an instructor, as I'm a teacher, I need to do assessment. It is a part of the game. I have to evaluate the students. Are they studying properly? That is my duty. I have to do it. But what concern? There are some concerns with me. What concerns do instructors have when they do have assessment, up select all that apply. So I hope the mentee is open. And participants, are you guys following the mentee or you need any support? Friends? Okay, everyone is following, I think. Hello friends. Yes, yes, yes. Only one person has participated in the poll. Two people have participated. Only two people have participated. Friends, kindly go to the menti.com. Kindly click the link what I have given. Please, you will enjoy. Assessment is a part. Polling is also one of the parts. It's a collaborative tool. Please participate. Forty-one people are there in the course. Only four people have participated. Friends, kindly write what concerns do instructors have in assessment. When I do assessment, I have some concerns, sir. I don't know whether students are engaged in my classroom, because to check whether the students engage in the classroom, an assessment is needed. To check the students are learning, assessment is needed. Predominant of the time, the students are confused what instructors want them to do. That is the reason they are failed. Because the question is not clear. Sometimes when we question the students in the classroom, what happened when we question the students in the classroom, he might provide a wrong answer. It is not the reason he has not learned the answer. Maybe our question also might have confused them. So one of the good attribute what we tell to the teachers, try to bring out the answers by redefining your question, fine-tuning your question, get the students to answer it. That is the one up. There are some students who will made an option they will never answer. That is a different scenario. But students by default can provide a wonderful answer. Please, friends, there are 44 people are there. At least minimum 20 people can participate. Please, I just want the people to go to Menti, share the link even in mobile phone. You can click the link and you can just participate in the mobile phone too. I just want the participants to participate. is on, I think. Thing I told, okay, sorry, I myself made a mute. I don't know, maybe the participants are feeling a little bit shy.
Sir, there might be different reasons.
Okay, no problem. Okay, 10 people have answered. I will go to the next question. Let me go, because I just want you to, it's a training, sir. It should not be one-way traffic. If you drive the car in one-way traffic, sometimes you will feel sleepy. You will feel bored. Someone should come in the opposite direction. You should cross. You should go in the wrong direction. He should go in the wrong direction. You both should fight. Then the warmth of the driving will be there. You remember? Like a talk show, like a debate show. But a debate show is ultimately nothing is useful. They debate for point of time, their TRP rates. But nothing is going to come out of the debate. It should not be like that. Okay. But I am very much surprised and happy to note the participants who participated, 11 people, they gave option of student cheat during assessment as a last option. Fantastic. Because I think the 11 faculty members who have participated in the poll, the students are really extremely good. They are not cheating. If they are cheating, that should be the first concern. I have given this question to different people. So some people, they have selected students cheat during cheating. If the students are cheating, then predominant mistake is with the faculty members. But now it is not with faculty members. You guys are very clever. You guys are very good doing the executing your duty extremely well. Extremely fabulous duty. Fabulous. Amazing.
Sir, there may be the many reasons that for assessment.
Yes. Many reasons. Yes, tell me, sir.
So student remains absent and next day they comes, they don't do anything.
Yes, they don't do anything. Yes. The reason I will tell you. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, somehow directly or indirectly, we made assessment as a stress game. That is a problem. But when it comes to the skill of their games, if they want to show their games, if they want to show their cycling skill or swimming skill, always students wants to show off. You remember that we call it as a social presence. The three presence, we have to test it, because there are three presence the students will have: social presence, cognitive presence, and teaching presence, or learning presence we call. Social presence, suppose if the students knows anything, if he knows anything, new item in the mobile phone, he will try to always exhibit to the students, his fellow learners. See, I know this skill. I know this app. That's a smartness. They want always getting recognition. participating in a discourse. That is a general trend. But unfortunately, when it comes to the examination related to studies, they get stressed. All stomach pain, all medical bills, everything will be more. That is a problem. We will just see one by one, sir. Let me go to the next question to my friends. The friends, I'm going to the next question. Assessment is easy for the following content. When it comes to assessment, these are the content very easily I can do assessment. I know it's very easy, sir. The students are also feels very happy. I will also feel very happy to do the assessment in the case of procedural knowledge or in the case of facts. Okay, facts, easy. Sometimes some people are very good in demonstrating the skills. You remember, they may not do good in theory paper, but they do good in practical paper. They do very good practicals. So amazing. I have seen some Takwambo where there was a guy from Assam. He was finding difficult in the theory paper. But when it comes to the practical paper, extremely he is doing good. So is it not something different, or is it not something need to be noted down, or something which the teacher has to take into account? That is very, very important. So assessment is easy for the following content. As per your views, as per your opinion, assessment is easy for which of the following content? I request the participants to be proactive in participating in the poll. No audio. I have given audio, Umayal madam, Umayal PSN. I have given audio. Yes. I request the participants to give the poll. Please, please. Yes, amazing, amazing. Only 5 people have participated. At least last poll, 11 people have participated. Friends, be reactive, be reactive, be reactive. Be participative, be participative. I'm audible only, but because I'm just observing your views, I just want to see the fact, because when I see the results, sometimes I might tend to influence your results. I don't want to influence your results. I don't want to speak when you're polling, because I'm giving 2 minutes to 5 minutes. I'm just observing your poll results. That is the reason, nothing more than that. Because actually, assessment is easy for conceptual knowledge. Fantastic. Assessment is easy for procedural knowledge. Amazing, because it's going to test the memory, remembrance level, recall. And so obviously what they can do, explain the procedure, everything. Factual knowledge is easy. Metacognitive is amazingly true. It is very, very difficult to assess, because metacognitive skill is a higher order domain. Agam Brahmasmi. You are enlightenment, achieving the enlightenment, top scientist, because knowledge about the knowledge, it takes time. Affective domain also, as you told, is amazingly correct. It is very difficult to assess, because the students pretend as if they are very disciplined, very obedient, very time consuming, everything very, very, very nicely they will act, but only for this semester. Next semester, its attitude might change. Now, I'm not telling all students, there are few students. So, affective domain is very difficult to evaluate. There are three domains generally evaluation is focused. One is cognitive domain, second is a psychomotor domain, third is an affective domain. We call it as a CAP, C-A-P, cognitive, affective, and psychomotor. Cognitive domain assessment predominantly contains the qualitative plus quantitative. Because if you see the affective domain, it is a qualitative, predominantly qualitative. Because your motivation, your affection, your commitment, your attitude is measured by an expert may not have the same results. You remember, there are some people, because for example, even the wrong person might have some fan club might be there. So it doesn't mean that they are wrong, because their fan club celebrates them. There might be some right person, but who might be thought as a wrong, that is also there. Affective domain varies, the evaluation varies depending upon the individual's perception of evaluation, individual perception or capability of evaluating the right thing. Because even if it's right, the people might come and bad. Even if the people are bad, they might come and right. So the affective domain variation is different. Only 11 people said, I don't know, 11 is a unique number, lucky number for me for this batch, I think. Out of 47, only luckily 11 is answering. I will put it chat question once again, chat link once again. My friends, kindly participate in the poll. Collaborative learning is important for the success or implementation of the learning. Okay, let me go to the last question. Let me go to the last question, my dear friends. First question, voting I have closed. How many people have answered? 11 people have answered. Okay, this thing, I will open the voting also if you want. Second, 11 people. Okay, fantastic. And third question, what question comes to your mind about assessment? Ask us. Let us together explore. Some people have told all assessments are done, are the assessment done at present correct? He is asking whether it's right or wrong. Okay, all assessments are correct, sir. Only the way in which we interpret the score, or way in which we represent the score, or way in which we analyze, that makes us different. Or we have to fine tune it. All cooking are good, because that some people like the taste. Doesn't mean that it is, because recently I used to go to the abroad, because Chinese food of rice is different taste. Their vegetarian food, different taste. But I can tell, is it the right way of cooking? No, I cannot tell it's right. Because the perception varies. But it also differs from the condition to condition, from perception to perception. We will discuss one by one. I just want the views of the participants to tell what questions comes to your mind when it comes to the assessment. What question comes to your mind? Press enter. Yes, I'm entering. Okay. Only 2 questions came.
Sir, the third question is not coming. We are not unable to type anything in that, sir.
Why, ma'am?
Again and again, we are getting the second question only.
No, no, the people are typing. The people are typing.
First time itself, I have typed it and sent whether the assessment is correct. That I only sent. Second time, I cannot type. Is it, sir?
Ah, yes, only one time you can type.
Okay. Or the assessment done in or at present is correct. That I only typed. That is what. Okay, sir.
Super movie, Albert. Okay, I have only five people are answering. I don't know what is the reason behind it. The people are reactive or proactive or non-reactive. There are some substance which need some they are retarded or I don't know. I wonder there is some issue is going on. Some issue is going on. Let me think. I don't know what is the reason behind it. It's a correct. Did this possess any positive impact on student learning? Did this maybe some thinking? What positive impact? Okay, is correct evaluation method for all students in all aspects? Okay, that all the things which you have to debate itself, which you have to debate it, and we have to find out a solution. So that is the reason which we are working on it. Let's work. Let's listen. Let's listen. What exactly the things are there? How the things could be interpreted? How the things could be assessed, we will see, and we will see today. And let me go to the presentation. What are the fundamentals which need to be looked into it? Let me discuss. Once again. Okay. So formative assessment, it's, I have told, the people have told, the formative, this possesses any positive impact on student learning. Okay, let me see whether it possesses the positive impact or how the impact is created. Because ultimately we have to see, friends, because the today's session is focusing on, I'm getting only second question, sir. Third question is not, slide is not changed. Hopefully everyone, it should get Kausalya Devi, madam. I don't know what is the reason. Only five people have answered. Not a big issue. Maybe I will just check it. I'm pausing it. I'm resuming scroll, shortcut resume scroll. I'm just resuming, but it's not working out. I don't know. I didn't close the voting. Is also now only, it's open only. Okay. No problem. Okay. Okay. Let it be. Let it be. Let it be. I'm just making a point of this thing. Friends, now let us listen what exactly we mean by the assessment and how it works out and what are the ways it works out. Everything we will see one by one, because assessment, if the assessment tool is having a problem, by default it's not going to give a value what we did. So if the assessment itself, it's a tool is having a mistake, by default assessment is going to be a mistake. For example, if I'm measuring the length of the table, if the length of the table, when I measure, if the length of the table which I measure using the scale, if the scale is having the error, by default the length of the table is going to be erroneous. So it's not going to provide the correct results. So it all depends upon the scale, what you use, the measurement type, what do you use, and ultimately it is also about the interpretation what we use. For example, let us presume there are two teachers are there, because I am handling one master's program, civil infrastructure engineering and management. One of my colleague is coming and asking how the students' performance in the laboratory, in the concrete laboratory. It's interpreting skills, or his measurement skills, how he performs in the laboratory. If I answer him, yes, he is in the 10th percentile, or if I answer, he gets 60%, he gets 70%, what happened? And he performs average. If I tell like that, it all depends upon the normative evaluation, sir. But he asked with respect to the criteria. Because my score, what he has obtained in the laboratory, if I give, if he is not in the position to decode what he wants from the students, then the evaluation is going to have a problem. So we need to have a clear-cut idea whether it's a norm reference or criterion reference, or whether the assessment scale is appropriate, whether measuring this feeling using this technique, is it correct or wrong? Because suppose if I am testing the mathematical skill, or is it English skill? There are some questions which I have. Maybe I can show it to you. It all depends upon what skill you are going to measure. That matters a lot rather than this thing. So interpretation plays an important role. Assessment also plays an important role. Let us focus on the insight about the assessment. Insight about the assessment, let us focus. And we will see one by one. So what are the tools to gauge and how it works out? So as usual in this lecture, the content expressed are purely my technical perspective. It does not represent the organization to which I am affiliated. So I have seen you guys have participated in the poll, and let's see the linkages with the case studies and this thing. In the early days, if you observe the early days, the parents, the teachers were shouting at the students if they didn't perform very well. Nowadays, the students and the parents, they are shouting at the teachers if they are not doing the good grades. Because now it becomes the responsibility of the student. We all talk about student-centric learning, student-centric teaching. But the workload comes into the teacher. I have really observed in the developed country where I graduated, let it be US or in Malaysia or China or Germany, any country, what I observed is the responsibility of learning should lies to the students. They should own the responsibility. Then the assessment pattern becomes easier. That is an important item which we have to remember. So, or sometimes we have a same yardstick. We have a fair selection. Everybody has to take the same exam to climb the tree. That is also becomes a problem. So that way also we are landing in trouble. So we have to be very clear, very categorically clear. Fair selection has to be there, but how to take the exam. So everyone has to climb the tree. That is also a problem. So I cannot have a uniform system because I need to have a differentiated learning or differentiated instruction is needed to make a personalized learning and also make an individualized assessment. How to make an individualized assessment? Because individualized assessment, if I make, then it, whether it will be easy for us to compare the score. For that only, in outcome-based education, the fundamental definition of outcome-based assessment is learning is fixed, learning time varies. Learning is fixed, learning time varies. Here we are fixing the outcomes, expected outcomes. Expected outcomes is fixed. But the assessment could be a different part. No problem. Assessment could be a different part. Only I am seeing the outcome. What the outcome I have envisaged. What the outcome I have visualized to do it. That is very, very important. I am only focusing on the assessment, not on any other part. Outcomes, what I expect from the students. That is very, very important. So sometimes we create a testing environment where the learners are not provided with the appropriate testing conditions. What the learning condition? Because I might have taught them in a different, the assessment will be different. And finally, when they're doing it in the field, it is going to be different. There need to be some connectivity, some choice where the assessment and the teaching, everything should get aligned. When the three get aligned, the things will be entirely different. So how to make the alignment in line? That is very, very important that we have to discuss, that we have to take into consideration. How we are going to take into consideration, we'll see. And in the assessment, in the case of outcome-based education, there is no question of, are you qualified? You have to remember, in outcome-based education, ultimately, all are qualified. Only thing we are have to focus on, how to customize the teaching learning process, how to make the personalized learning, how to make the differentiated instruction. That is the need of the hour. So great teachers are made, not just born, and we will see Mentimeter. We have finished the Mentimeter code. And this is some joke which was there. I thought Stripe out to whistle is showing to his friend. The Stripe knows how to whistle. His friend is asking, I don't hear him whistling, but he is telling, I taught him. I didn't say he learned it. That is the approach what we are following at present. We are just teaching them. Are they learning? That is the question which you have to remember. It might be philosophical. It is not philosophical, sir. My request to the fellow teachers is the how to connect the students with the practical insight. That is very, very important. Because if the practical insights are connected, by default, our research will increase, our student commitment increase. But sometimes students are reading, but for the degree sake. I have seen before the lockdown, when I traveled once in the Ola to the airport, I was seeing one young guy was on Saturday. I was asking him, he is a student of engineering college. In Saturday and Sunday, he is working as a driver for a QuickBooks. But I was wondering, I told him, because for a small short-term benefit, you are losing your long-term career because you cannot achieve anything without any tapas. Because the discipline, Keno Upanishad clearly tells, discipline is important for any studies. That is very, very important. So it is assessment that helps us distinguish between the teaching and learning. We'll quickly look into the assessment. There are different assessment tools are there at present. One of the assessment tools in the online is Flipgrid. Flipgrid.com is there where you can make the students to provide their feedback. it is not the feedback alone to assess their learning capability. For example, during the COVID, I was handling online classes. What I used to do, I used to give the students a condition where they have to listen to the lecture and give their views and opinions in the terms of flipgrid videos. For 90 seconds, 60 seconds, they have to give it. So it helps us to check whether the students have learned appropriately or not. That is the important aspect. That is the important aspect which I've learned. So I need to be in the position to check whether the students have learned or not, how they learned, what are the aspects they have learned, everything they are getting it. So that is the one aspect which you have to remember. So how we have to make it, how the things could be made, that is the reason which we have to work on it, So Flipgrid, and I just skip this picture, this is not needed. So are we doing old things in a new way, or is it a new thing in a new way? But you have to remember, the most important time to be in education, this is the most important time to take care about the education. This is the most important time where we can create impact in education. If the assessment is not proper, if the students are coming out without assessment, they are going to be a problem or a residue to the system. We don't want to have the residue. Somehow we have to devise a methodology where assessment clearly measures what is the intended learning outcome of the particular subject or for particular course of expertise, what we are going to give degree. So that is very, very important. So this is the most important time to be in education. This is the most important time to take care about education. This is the most important time to impact the education. Impact the education. This is most important. Because the Brundtland, the father of assessment, the Brundtland, because Brundtland objectives, you might be knowing specific objective, general objectives and specific objectives. You should know the state. The students go to the college to learn, not to take test. In addition, test cannot be used as a indicate the student's ability to do the level of learning. All tests do rank students in the order of achievement, and their relative ranking is influenced by guessing, by bluffing, and the subjective opinion of the teacher during the scoring. The teaching learning process would benefit if it did away with the test and depended on student self-evaluation. So this is a statement of Brundtland, and we have to be very clear. And if you see in the educational institution, the scores and grades are very, very important. Based on the scores and grade, only the job is obtained. But getting a score or grade, either I can go for formative assessment or summative assessment. One of our madam or sir, he has questioned during the Mentimeter quiz, how to do the formative assessment, because the formative and the side figure also in the picture which I have shown a bigger stone for formative and smaller size stone for summative, because formative assessment plays an important role in redefining the process. You have to remember, the formative assessment really redefine the process. So that gives a more advantage. So formative assessment gives the redefinition of the process. Whereas summative assessment, only final brand making, because finally, whether it has been achieved or not, for that purpose, only the summative assessment. So my focus has to be on the formative assessment. How the formative assessment need to be there, how it could be done, and what are the ways and means which we could do the formative assessment. That is the major focus which I have to work on it, because if I am not focusing on the formative assessment, by default summative assessment will not give the intended result. That also I have to be very clear, because if the formative is not good, summative is not going to be good. To put an analogy, if I cook, I need to check while cooking the food whether salt is good or chili powder is good. If I am not doing, finally if I evaluate, that is not going to give me any results, because it's, by the time everything will be ready and everything will be about to serve, if the error is there, then we will be having issue in evaluating. So the formative assessment is very big, and that need to be taken into consideration. That plays an important role to provide the summative assessment also. Summative assessment also, it plays an important role. So what are the challenges and solutions? If you see the challenges and solutions, you have to remember the challenges and solution is not focusing on the content-based teaching or content-based assessment. It has to focus on the context-based assessment. What do you mean by context-based assessment? Because when you see most of the colleges, when we go for BOAs, I have been to one of the very famous college in Madurai for BOAs. They told all their students are tested in higher order domain. I was amused. Okay, fantastic. Can you show me one question paper in higher order domain? I was. They have shown, but it's not higher order domain. I'll tell you. The subtle difference in higher order, that is very famous college for very old college, government aided, and it is also talks a lot about Bloom's taxonomy. I'm talking in terms of civil engineering. So I observed the questions, what was supposed to be in higher order, it is not at all higher order. It is only testing their understanding of this thing. They thought if analysis of singly reinforced beam, they know analysis, the questions are set at analysis level. Not at all, not at all. It is only checking whether the student understood the method or analysis of self singly reinforced beam. Whether we are checking whether they are in the position to know the analysis of doubly reinforced beam. Like that, that is the reason. Analysis basically plays an important role. It is a content, it is not the question of content. It is a question of context-based assessment. So provide a situation, provide the condition, and ask the students to get evaluate the students. So it provides a better clarity, it provides a better perspective, so that they will be answering in a different manner. So that is very, very important. So content-based knowledge, it is not context. It should be context-based assessment rather than the content assessment. Content assessment, it goes to the just rote learning. They learn it, they buy got it, and they will submit it. So, but we have to focus on the context-based assessment rather than the content-based assessment. Is it clear, sir? Is it clear? It is not content-based assessment. It is predominantly to check whether it is going to be good or not. It has to be a context-based assessment. If you connect the assessment context-based assessment, the students will remember evergreen, and their performance also improves accordingly. That is the advantage. So let us together explore the future assessment, but students are blindfolded in learning. That is a problem, because students are completely blindfolded in learning. They don't know whether they are doing it correct or wrong, because they are thinking they are they have to see how it works out. How it works out, we have to see, and we have to work accordingly. Work accordingly. Okay. Where is the key? Key is the key is the database. So it is impossible to redesign students to fit into a system. We can redesign a system for the students. We can redesign a system for the students. That is a wonderful advantage we are having, and accordingly we can work on it. Accordingly we can work on it, sir. Accordingly we can work on it, and it provides a better perspective. I'll tell you, it provides a better perspective. It provides a better value to the students, and that's the way it works out. So that's the way it works out. So amazingly, it works out in the direction. So no problem for us. That is the advantage which we have to think about it, and we have to work accordingly. We have to work accordingly. Okay. We can redesign a system to fit into a system. So the information is plenty. The information is plenty, and the information should lead to the further discussion. Information should lead to the further discussion, and let me focus. Sometimes you wonder how because when we make assessment, it is not our path is easy, because we are setting the question papers with tough, but students' learning path assessed is comfortable. What's the next step for you? We'll quite think big. And you should know what is the difference between assessment and evaluation. Assessment, fundamental definition of assessment is the accessory to sit side by where there is a scope for the students to grow. Assessment means there is a scope for improvement. Accessory sit side by where the students should sit side by and they have to do with and for students and not to the students. That is very, very important. They have to sit and they have to help the students to work in a different perspective. And assessment, the purpose of measuring the something with the purpose of assigning a numerical value. Because when we do assessment, we assign the numerical value, 80, 60. But that numerical value is not going to give the what exactly it means. Only when you make it as an evaluation, it makes. Because when you compare that assessment results with some standard benchmark, it becomes evaluation. So we have to remember assessment is a process of measuring something, and evaluation is the process of determining worth of something in relation to the established benchmark using assessment information. So that is it. So how it is going to be useful? So their evaluation is quantitative description plus qualitative description plus value judgment. So when it comes to rubrics, the role of feedback, we use, it is known as a qualitative assessment. We use rubrics. There are methods through which the rubrics could be measured. I will just go through quickly because I have to complete because time. So the evaluation could be three processes. So prior to the instruction, we call it as a preparatory or diagnostic. Second, it is a formative during the instruction. And third, it is a summative on completion of the instruction. So the three things we have to interpret: before or prior to instruction, during the instruction, on completion of the instruction. That is there. So all together is comprehensive instruction. And formative test is evaluation to learning. It is evaluation for learning. That is a formative. And summative is evaluation of learning. To evaluate for learning, and evaluate of learning. So that is the three things which we will be working on it, which we will do. Then evaluation should be based on clearly stated objectives, because sometimes if you want to measure the students, are they eligible for one domain, that you have to see only that. Then only the evaluation results will be clear. If you still stated objective is one, evaluation is one, then it is not going to give any results. You have to remember, the evaluation should be based on the clearly stated objectives. Clearly stated objectives. And it should be comprehensive, and it should be cooperative. It should be used judiciously and continuous and integral part of the teaching and learning process. And it is the evaluation which you have to remember. So what are the ways it should be results to be defined, discussed? Once it is measured, it should be measured. Identify the data source required and sources, and review the existing methodology, what you are using it. And finally, add additional methods and measures. And then it comes the implementation and evaluate. And finally, it once a loop is closed. So that's the way the evaluation goes. And validity, because they told that, discuss about the characteristics of the evaluation. In the characteristics of the evaluation, there are two characteristics which we predominantly discuss. One is validity, second is reliability. Validity is whether the test measures what it intend to measure. That is very, very important, because when I see the question paper in academic auditing, we just check whether the validity is there and reliability is there. And also we check on the difficulty level and discrimination index. So discrimination index is something, the number correct, upper level, how much many people, number correct, lower level, and total number of the students in the entire group, we take it. Then we find the discrimination index. We find the difficulty level. We find the discrimination is positive. Do distractors discriminate negatively? Because of the distractors, whether the discrimination as index has become less negative, because not negative, how it works. So we do in that calculation, the academic auditing. Generally, when we go characteristics, what we do is validity. Whether a test measure, what is intent to measure, that is very, very important. And what it intend to measure, because the validity does the required sampling of questions to cover the various topics and ability to be tested. That is a content validity. So does the test includes proper sampling? For example, in Anna University, 5 units, each unit some set of mark is fixed. So that is that we are not giving a weightage. One unit 20 mark, another unit 30 mark, another unit 40 mark. Not like that. We have some pattern. Proper sampling. We have already given the guideline for sampling of questions. So does the test include proper sampling of questions to cover the various topics and ability to be tested? That is a content validity. Second comes. So second, we focus on the construct validity. Whether the test be able to provide the scores matching with the spread of achievement among the students. That is very, very important. Whether it provides achievement among the students, the speed of achievement, the spread of achievement, because when we are measuring certain things, it should results in the achievement. Whether are they really reflect the learning only? Are they provides a view for us to interpret the learning capability? That is very, very important. That is the second criteria which you have to remember, sir. So are they going to validity, construct validity, content validity? There are two more validity we see: predictive validity and concurrent validity. For example, 7 + 7 + 7, this is there. If it is there, what is the correct answer and share? Here, I am not going to check the students. Are they know plus? Are they go division? Are they know multiplication? Are they subtraction? That is not my testing. I am planning to test whether the students knows the Bhatmas rule. That is, which operator need to be done first, whether it is addition first or multiplication first, or division first, or subtraction first. There is a rule how the mathematical operators need to be operated, which one need to be operated first. I just want to now have the testing of whether the students possess enough knowledge to test whether are they following the rule for this one, the test. That is the important aspect we have to see. It is not the multiplication. It is not division. It is not subtraction. It is not addition. It is how the skill works. That is the main focus which we are working on it. So the important question: to what extent the interpretation of the results will be appropriate, meaningful, and useful, and what extent it will be free from error, and what extent it relates to validity, what extent it relates to reliability. So validity is the meaning of validity, interpreting and using the assessment results, which could be grasped and most easily by reviewing the following characteristics. And validity is inferred from the available evidence, and validity depends upon the different types of evidence. Validity expressed by the degree, i.e. or morality. Validity specific for a particular use, and of course validity could be called into inference drawn most of the instrument. And validity is a unitary concept. It's a unitary concept. It is not, you have to remember, if the question paper is valid, by default it is reliable. If the question paper is reliable, doesn't mean that it is valid. So you have to just see validity and reliability from a different perspective, but that we have to see accordingly. We have to work on it, because validity and reliability plays an important role based on the perspective. So that is the main focus which we are focusing. So that has to be discussed and debate. Validity refers to the inference drawn. Validity is a unitary concept. We have to see how it is there and how it operates, and concerned with the consequences of the assessment degree and specific. And the validity could be grouped into content validity, criterion validity, construct validity, and consequence validity. Content or predictive validity. Predictive validity, what I mean is, if the students are tested in the physics, chemistry, and mathematics, and the entrance examination, and if they get a good score, we predict they will be good in the engineering. If they get a bad score, we think there is some weakness or flaw which may not be, so they may not be the successful while reading the engineering subjects. So the validity, predictive validity, gives whether the outcome of the student will be achieved if you check with the predictive validity. Some people will do biology and max physics, so physics, chemistry. So if they do these three subjects, obviously by default, the learning is good. They will perform very well. So suppose if you do these physics, chemistry, mathematics, they will be good in engineering. That is the predictiveness. We are not testing them on engineering subjects. We are not testing. Suppose we are asking for architecture. We are asking aptitude test and drawing. So we are forecasting if they do perform good in this, by default, they will be performed better in the other areas. That is the forecasting which we do accordingly, we are working on it. So the predictive validity, content validity, construct validity, concurrent validity, whether the validity appears at a particular interval of a particular position after some particular interval of time. So that is it. So content, criteria, construct, and predictive validity or consequences validity, we call it, which we have. So content validity, relationship between the test items and the subject related task. Construct validity, it seems to be agreement between theoretical concepts and specific measuring device or procedure. Mathematics, I have shown that is an example. Concurrent validity, using a correlation, a logical method, whether there is a correlation between the test score. If I am performing the test today, if I am performing the test tomorrow, my results are going to be same. That way the question should be there. It should not vary. So, for example, yesterday, I got the answer. This today also, I have to get the same X. But if they are giving some different answer, then there is no correlation. But there might be a chance for difference. That is different. But sometimes in the survey, everything, what happened, the students randomly, they tick as if they can take care of it. But they are not performing good. So the concurrent validity is the validity which we will be checking at a different phase of time, different situation. The participants lead to the same answer, And predictive validity, I told you, the future performance. If the examinees does good, and it is good, they will be doing good in the future. That is a validity concepts, validity. But reliability, if the question paper is reliable, doesn't mean that the students is, the question paper is valid also. But if the question paper is valid, by default, the question paper is also a reliable question paper, that has to be. So the important criteria which you need to look into it when you do, we have to look at it. We have to remember when we do it is nothing but the content validity and construct validity. So that way we have to work on it. So we have to see how the content validity and construct validity it's going to be there. That way we have to forecast, and that way we have to work on it, content and construct validity. So that has to be re-looked into it, that has to be worked out. So factors affecting inadequate sampling of test content, questions irrelevant to the objective, ambiguity in the questions, unclear directions, inappropriate level of difficulty, all those things comes under the factors affecting the validity and improper arrangement of the questions. So reliability is determined as a consistency of the test results, irrespective of one item, because that you have to remember, reliability refers to the consistency of the measurement, how consistent the test score are there from one measurement to another measurement. Because even if I answer in the morning, even if I answer in the afternoon, the answer results the same. That is known as a reliability. Methods of testing the reliability is test retest method, parallel methods, alternate methods, split off method, and internal consistency method, and score reliability method. Basically, reliability test, we will just use it during our academic auditing. Predominantly, we will use this one during our academic auditing. Whether the students, because we take the topper of the students, middle level of the students, bottom of the students, and we look into it, and we work on it. That is it. Because sometimes guessing matters a lot, because upper of one answer, lower of not covered in the entire test, because the guessing, to avoid the guessing and to avoid the ambiguity, we do this thing so that it gives a better perspective for us. So there are intrinsic factor and eccentric factor, test length, poor quality of questions, bias, sampling of content, and allowing wide choice of questions, optional, open option, internal choice, arbitrary time limits for each answering, because for all answer, you cannot have the equal time. It depends upon the condition, and it has to be focused. So that is that. So, and then factors affecting eccentric factors are unsatisfactory conditions of timing of administration, late night, late evening, all those things. We have to see when the students are active. That way we have to see it is an unsatisfactory condition. Subjective in scoring by evaluation, because objective and subjective. Objective type, you cannot manipulate the scoring. Whereas subjective, the one teacher may not give a different for same class, the same answers. One might have given four if the scheme of evaluation is not there. So it may not be operative. So I can show you a fisherman captures a finotush wearing 100 kilograms. As he meets a friend, after he tells that weight of the fish he caught is 130 grams. In statistical sense, the story is reliable and it is more consistent. You remember, I can accept it. Okay, I can just see, yes, it's reliable. But whether it is truthfulness for the fisherman story, it is not established because it is not valid but reliable. Because a test could be reliable, but doesn't mean that it has to be valid. A test could be reliable, doesn't mean that it need to be valid. But the test, whichever it's valid, is always reliable. A test which is valid, is always reliable. So we have to remember how the testing compulsorily it has to be validity, and it has to be reliable also. Valid is reliable, but reliable doesn't mean that it is valid. So this is like this, because all are hitting at the bullseye. It is valid and reliable. Here everyone are hitting at the wrong corner. It is reliable, but they are not valid because all are giving the same answer. Doesn't mean that the answer is correct. That you have to remember. All are giving a correct answer, but it is the same and it is reliable. It's reliable and valid. So that is valid. A test may be reliable without being valid, but a test has to be reliable without valid. So that is there. And usability, generally we see a positive skewness and negative skewness, because generally rubrics. So rubrics, generally we need a rubrics for evaluating the qualitative assessment. For qualitative assessment, rubrics is needed. Because for example, project evaluation, for any other thing, we need a rubrics. Otherwise, we cannot get the rubrics. In the rubrics, we have to remember two things. I didn't show the screen. So this is excellent, good, satisfactory, needs improvement, and then some scales of this thing, because we call the scale of evaluation, the descriptors of the evaluation, the yardstick used. For example, if I'm giving a T, if Basim might take T, if he takes T, and if I take T, I might tell the T is very excellent, but my Basim is telling good tea, but I am telling excellent tea, because he might have tasted a better tea than this thing. He might prepare a good tea also. That is also there. So a qualitative assessment comes with a prior experience. If you have a prior experience, prior knowledge, your evaluation will vary. For example, two examiners are going to evaluate the students, two different batches of projects. Some project evaluator might be tough and some project might not be tough. So scaling has to be done appropriately to bring everyone to the same yardstick. That is the need of the hour that we have to remember. So the rubric is a score to assess the performance along a specific set of criteria rather than a single numerical score. So it is outstanding, satisfactory, inadequate performance. Generally, we will not get poor performance. We tell needs improvement or inadequate performance. Accordingly, we will work on it. So do you know it? Can you use it? So we will see set of objectives, scoring criteria, level of performance and descriptors. Scale is given, the dimension which I am measuring, and the descriptors is also given. This is a template. So how to work on it? Because I will tell you one easy method is, we go for NSF site. NSF, National Science Foundation, has given a site known as rubystar.forteachers.org. If you go to rubystar.forteachers.org, where you can create your own rubrics. I'm just copying it and providing the link in the chat box so that it gives a more clarity to the students. Okay, rubystar.forteachers.org. So I'm creating a rubric. What happened? Let me create a rubric for laboratory report. Let me take my name, Dr. Janardhan Gathulasi, lab report of environmental engineering laboratory report. I am outside United States, because in Chicago it is 9-9, but outside United States, 5 times 9, I have to type. My rubric is temporary. So here I have to provide the scale. I told you scale, dimensions, and finally we have to provide the descriptor scale. Satisfactory. Okay. in the category, I have to just think, first one is a background source. When I click, automatically it fills the descriptors. It helps us to guide you. Remember, I can write from, instead of several reputed background source, I can type IS codal provision is followed and referred. I can customize, because it gives my idea how I can make an excellent, good, satisfactory needs improvement. These days in Google Classroom also, you are forced to give rubrics. Even in Canvas LMS, we give rubrics to the students, everything we do. So background source, procedures, and we can give diagrams if the students are drawing, and we can give a safety method. We can check how they are doing the calculation part, and we can see how they are doing the conclusion part. Everything. So I can submit it. I can provide the submit button. The rubric is available. Either I can use this rubric or download it in the form of Excel sheet. I can use it. I can download it in the form of Excel, and I can distribute to the students. This is the methodology which I'm going to evaluate you. That is very clear. More clarity is provided so that the students will not get confused. The student will not get confused, and they will get a clear idea. So that is the advantage. So rubystar.forteachers.org, because where we can provide the rubrics. So, and here you can give the collaboration rubrics. The task force participation, I can give 20%, dependability 20%, listening skills for 20, and information and research sharing, I can give 40%. In the dimensions, I can vary the dimension score. I can vary accordingly. So this is known as analytic rubrics. The descriptive rubric, holistic rubric, is one dimension. So that we use it in different places. Predominantly for our assessment, we use the analytic rubrics, analytics, because rubrics is a numerical score table which the qualitative assessment brought into a single dimension. That is the very, very important thing. So in the fundamentals of evaluation, you have to remember there are three different types of assessment are there. Formative assessment, summative assessment, preparatory assessment. Preparatory assessment is prior to the learning, and formative assessment during the process of learning, and summative assessment at the final stage of learning, that is summative. So formative, summative, and before that is a preparatory assessment. And in the case of assessment, we see the characteristics which are predominantly used is reliability and validity. There are two types of tests there. Norm reference test and criterion reference test. For example, among the classroom which you're going to evaluate, it is a norm reference test. For example, the military evaluation, they give a criteria. If you finish this criteria, meet this criteria, then only you will be selected. That is a criterion-based evaluation. So that way you have to remember. In the case of a rubric, as I told, assessment is nothing but a accessory to sit side by. Assessment is evaluation is nothing but quantitative measurement, qualitative measurement plus value judgment. And if you see the quantitative measurement and qualitative measurement, quantitative, it is evaluated through rubrics, and quantitative, any method, supply type method or selection type method, any method you can make it. So evaluation is nothing but assessment plus value judgment. Assessment plus value judgment. Assessment is nothing but the checking. What accessory to sit side by, where the scope is there for improvement. So, and rubrics is basically used for qualitative measurement to get an idea. So ultimately, if you see, the essence of education is to bring out the truth or correctness into you, from you, let out. That is the literal meaning of education, from oneself. The role of educator is not to provide the information alone. It is to make the students to let the students come out from themselves. That is to help them to recognize that learning is nothing but a self-discovery. That is the essence of evaluation. That is the essence of this thing. So there are a lot of videos of ours itself. It's available. Maybe it might be private. You can look into it. I have talked a lot about discrimination index, difficulty index. I have discussed. If you are interested, you can just look into the video. I can share the links, and hopefully you can collaborate. I don't know about my lecture. What I gave was... what is your perspective of the lecture? The lecture I gave us might be not well received. It might be boring. It might be rubbish. Or even you might tend to kill me. No problem. But that's the way the assessment So that's the insight. Insight you have to remember, and there is no question of right or wrong, because you have to remember it's not the question of right; it's a question of future. Because nowadays assessment plays an important role. If you're not doing assessment properly, it is going to reflect on various skills. So let us do the right assessment with the right skill. So that is very, very important. I don't know whether I provided the information or misinformation. I cannot try it once again because it's already time's up. So I don't know whether I loaded you with several steps, but I tried to provide you what do you mean by the fundamental definition of assessment. Assessment is sit side by Latin word accessory. Evaluation is nothing but assessment plus value judgment. Assessment is nothing but quantitative measurement plus qualitative measurement. So the measurement, assessment, evaluation, value judgment, all the terminologies we have seen, there are two types of tests are there, norm reference test and criterion reference test. And the characteristics of evaluation, there are six characteristics are there, but I covered only two characteristics, validity and reliability. In validity, we have told content validity, construct validity, concurrent validity, and predictive validity. And reliability also, that how to do check that reliability test. I don't know, before starting the lecture, you might have thought what this guy is going to discuss, and you might have had a direction, but I hope this lecture might have provided you some spark, which will really provide you to think beyond the, this thing. And I hope whether in the race, we will win or not. But my question to the decision maker, whether we win the race, but I am pretty sure we are slow, but we are steady. So if you have any questions, any doubt, or any unanswered issues, ask me. I will be happy to answer you. And always you are welcome to mail me and send me on WhatsApp, because any doubts, further comments, unanswered question, unresolved issues, you can just ask me. And otherwise, thank you very much. And I do with for passion. And you can always get connected. And these are my email address and phone number. You can ask. Over to the participants if they have any questions or any doubt related to it. Someone has given some chat. Menti.com. Thank you, sir. Thank you for a nice presentation. Thank you, Nirmala Devi. Thank you, Menti.